fine. No, this paper contains both Rudyard Kipling puns and cake puns.
Somehow, if you could get Kipling on the same status as Curry, you would have done the
work. Yes, well, yes, and I also quote the famous Donald McGill postcard with the coy courting couple. He says, "Do you like Kipling?" And she replies, "I don't know you, naughty boy. I've never kibbled." Dreadful. But yeah, they're all in there. But anyway, there was an issue here about trying to trying to build a type theory in type theory. And let's see what sort of happened. Well, for a start, we need to say what contexts are, and then to say what types are, well, types are different things in different contexts. So we better make the type of types dependent on contexts. But oh look, what are contexts made from? They're different types. And then it gets even worse when we've got terms, when it's going to be a term in a context of a given type in that context. And yeah, but here of course, well, big if is where we say, well, actually, we're going to have a term type moving and use that to make a type. So, yeah, so people are trying doing this. And I mean, it looks kind of funny that you define a bunch of data types mutually, where the earlier ones are used to index the later ones. We certainly haven't seen any of those constructions in the story so far. That's, you know, this kind of definition is known to its friends as induction by analogy with induction recursion. And yeah, at the moment, you know, no one has placed inductive definitions. Well, that's not true. There's a recent paper by Anton Setzer and Frederick Forsberg on giving a rather complicated closed presentation of inductive definitions. But there's certainly room for a lot of further study to explain why this sort of inductive definition makes sense at all. But even if we are allowed to make inductive definitions, we're still in trouble. And we are in trouble in at least two ways. I haven't actually written down a constructor for variables here, or a type of variables. But where before, when we looked up a variable in the context, the type somewhere inside the context made sense at the point where the variable was being used. Now, by construction, the type of a variable comes from a different context to the place where the variable is being used. So somehow we have to explain how to weaken the type from the context at its point of usage. And that has to be built into this presentation. So how does that work, given that we're only trying to define what the syntax is in the first place, and now we needed to have a weakening operation already, even just to say what things are? That's one sense in which we are in trouble. But the other sense in which we're in trouble, which was the kind of clue to get out of it to me, is if you look at the application rule, here we're saying, once again, that we demand the coincidence of the domain type function with the argument type. But what coincidence are we demanding here? We're demanding a syntactic coincidence. That S is just a term. Whereas in type theory, an application is well typed if those two match up to judgmental equality. And usually, a type theory will be presented with a conversion rule, which just says a term of one type can be used at another type if they're judgmentally equal. But that rule is not syntax directed. It just says, you can just munch types by the judgmental equality any way you like without any marking in the term. So we could add a conversion rule to this bunch of mutual definitions, and we'd also, of course, have to define the judgmental equality. But that would be writing down the system of typing derivations. It would not be writing down the syntax. Right. I mean, all the rules we write down in this system, if we're trying to write down a type-safe syntax, we have to write down a marked up, a typed version of the grammar. We cannot have non-syntax directed rules and claim we're writing down the syntax. So at the point when I wrote this, all the previous attempts to model type theory and type theory had ended up modeling the derivation system rather than the syntax. Because of this determination that the coincidence in an application has to be a syntactic coincidence. And that was the thing which provoked me to think, what is the coincidence we actually want in the application book? Instead of demanding a coincidence in what these things say, we should demand a coincidence in what they mean. But perhaps we should start by trying to write down what the possible meanings of things are before we start trying to write down a syntax. That's where I got to in this file. So what are the meanings we're going to want in this this type theory? So this lecture's universe, U, is defined by induction and recursion. It's got some familiar components, I hope you'll see, but I have replaced all of the Petterson symmetries by the mere natural numbers, just to avoid that palaver. Here are helpful things like non-dependent arrow and product. And here's the implementation of type level if then else. So now we've got a universe that is carving out of Agda the types that we want to give a representation for in our type theory. So then we can start talking about what the bits and pieces are. So first of all, I can define what contexts are, or what, I can define, here I'm just lifting the semantic notion, the notion of the meaning of a type, the meaning of a type, or which types we are allowed to mean, lifting that to contexts. Which contexts are we allowed to give a representation to? Well, those would be, as you can see here, again defined by induction and recursion, the left nested records whose types are given in our universe. We want to be able to build contexts that are left nested dependent records from the types in our universe. And we interpret a context as an environment. And as you can see, to extend the context, you give a function from an environment for the context so far to a new type in the universe. Well, to a type in the universe that is going to end up new to the context. Okay, so that's. So these are the semantic objects we're talking about. We're talking about types, we're talking about environments and contexts. Now we can start discussing how to represent things. So let's just start with variables. So in the simple type version, we said we typed variables by saying, well, we indexed over types and context to say, well, you could look up something of this type from the context. So we can play the same game, except that now we have to say, well, what is playing a role of a type in this setting? What are we going to index by that plays the role of that type? Well, now types are context dependent, so the thing that plays the role of types in this setting are always functions from environments to you. So a type over G, which, yes, I've written G, I'll pronounce it gamma. A type over gamma is a function from gamma environments to the universe. So now we can say, how to look up a variable in the context and get a type represented in this form. Well, we can say maybe it's the top variable, and if the context looks like gamma extended by t, then what is the type of that variable as a gamma type? Well, t, so as a gamma comma t type, right? We've got to give a type for that variable in this context, in gamma t. The t is a function from gamma environments. But great, if we've got a function from gamma environments, we can make a function from a longer environment just by projecting out the bit we're interested in. So t is a function from gamma environments to make a function. Maybe if I use the interactive features of Agda, then I get moaned at, of course. But if we look at, you can see what we need here is a function from gamma t environments. And if I ask, what's the type of, I just say, what have we got? See, t is a function from gamma environments, and we need a function from gamma t environments. But great, because as you can see, a gamma t environment is a pair whose first component is a gamma environment. So there is how we manage weakening. Weakening is just projection from big environments to small environments in this semantic representation of the types. Because we're working with the semantic objects, we don't have to implement weakening as an operation over the syntax. It's just a projection from an environment. And then similarly, if we can already get, if we can get a, if we have a variable in gamma of type t, then we can make a variable in gamma extended by s, and again, we have to modify the environment. happy with that. We say, oh, we can make a variable in the longer environment. That just means we have to throw away even more stuff than we were already throwing away.
Could you just scroll back to your universe?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Once we've got variables, then we actually need to implement. Now we can say, well, if you have a variable of type t in gamma, then we can really take a gamma environment and produce an element of the type indicated, where now that's depending on the environment. And so what do we do? If it's the top variable, then it corresponds to this sort of a context, and our t is just sitting there as the second component of the environment. Otherwise, if it's further back in the context, we just take the first projection of the environment and keep going. So we can interpret variables as functions from environments. Except that's just what we did before. Except that previously, the type of the thing we were extracting didn't depend on the context. But now it does. That's okay. It's the same machinery for interpreting variables still touch us. Okay. And then I've done some of the boring ones, but left lots of the exciting ones. Now, we can make a mutual definition of what it means to be a type and what it means to be a term. Now we're actually going to give the syntax. And the syntax is really going to be saying which types seen as functions from environments to the universe, which of those functions it has a syntactic presentation. So here I'm saying that 0, 1, 2, and nat as concrete terms are presentations of the constant functions. Here k is the k combinator. Constant functions from environments to 0, 1, 2, and that, the types in the universe. So let's get this clear. The primed things are the types in the universe, and the all caps things are the syntax of the type theory that we're modeling. Okay. And we can also. Yeah, so this is, yeah, these are the types, these are the terms. And you notice that they're the same thing here. We're saying this type is representable. And here I'm saying that this type is inhabited. So this is type representability, this is type inhabitation. I could, if I wanted to, also index this by a value and talk about representability of values. Do that all the way along, this construction would still work. But I don't need to do that, and indeed, rather than doing that, I'm instead defining, as part of it, this is an inductive recursive definition, defining an interpreter for the terms. And how do we interpret a term? As you'd expect, it's now a dependently typed function from environments to the corresponding interpretation of the type.
Where do you interpret the text in the declaration? In the data declaration?
In the data, well, the point is that the types are indexed by their interpretation. So I don't need to write an interpreter for the types. Because they're already indexed by their meaning. And that allows me, crucially, to say what type the interpreter for the terms will give back. So the meaning of the types is the thing that we need to index by, because those are the things, those are the coincidences we need to arrange. We could index by the meanings of the terms, but we're not going to need to do that.
As this semantic universal leaks into somehow, when you want to program with this syntax, then you have to somehow supply a given point, the actual meaning of terms to make things structure.
You can write a lot of underscores. Indeed, I do. So let's see. We want to do some more exciting things. I'll resist, although here I've written k, the k combination of constant functions from environments. I learned my lesson from giving this talk. You can actually write this stuff doing an awful lot of bracket abstraction with s and k, but it leaves people none the wiser. It's just showing off. So I'll write it out. You're going to want pi types, so what do they consist of? There'll be an S and a T. What's the type? What's T going to be?
What's the type of S?
So yes, I can write down the type of S if you like. It's the S is one of these things. It's a function from gamma environments to the universe. And T in a traditional, T is going to bind a variable. So it's going to be a function, did I call it comma by any chance? Yes. T is going to bind a variable, right? So that's, those are the things we hope to represent. But
can we skip that for all now that we have given the signature?
Yes, we can skip that. And then we want to say, guess what? Not only do we, those are the meanings, but moreover, they are representable. And under those circumstances, we have a representation for O. The function from environments, which gives back a pi type. In order to create a modicum of suspense, let's do lambda first. But, I mean, what's it going to be? I think I'll be copying and pasting this a lot. Those are the types involved. We're going to have, but what are the terms involved? We're going to have a term over the context GS, and the type of that term, the body of the lambda, is going to be a T. You get to decide whether you want to a type annotation on the lambda or not. We could demand that S is representable. But I'm not sure I can be bothered. Yeah. Shall we have typed lambdas or untyped lambdas?
Oh, typed.
Typed lambdas, okay.
He's going for it.
So that means we need a G slash S as well. So you have to provide us with a representation of the domain. And then we will have something that lives in that PyType. And now it's saying, I don't know how to make one of those, so I haven't returned one of those, but unfortunately. Right, so now we have to give a function from environments to elements of a PyTorch. but what is it, right? That's to say, it's going to be given an environment and then it has to make an element of a PyType. So it gets given an input. But the body is a term which makes sense over an environment for gamma and S. And we've got the two ingredients of such an environment. We've got an environment for gamma, and we've got an element of S. So we just interpret the term. That meant pretty much as we did when we were implementing the semi-type calculus. All right, let's do application. Guess what, folks? We'll close. And we'll need that. Better give back a suitably instantiated version of T. That's to say, we get given a gamma environment, and we've got a function T that will give back the type when instantiated with a what? A gamma S environment. Well, let's get started. We can certainly give one chunk of that, but now we need to get our S value. Ah, hang on a minute. We've got a term representing an S value. So why not interpret it? So then, instead of performing a substitution syntactically, we apply semantic type function to an appropriate environment. Then you build by extracting the semantics from the term, and then correspondingly, I bet. But like an S combinator. Let's just do it. Oh, of course. It's we've got to build our. We've actually got to evaluate it. So what do we do? Well, I don't actually know the answer, but we should interpret the function in an environment, and that will give us a function from values to values. So yes, we interpret the argument. And we could carry on. Well, some things are worth doing here actually. Although I might do a cut and paste job. But if we look at the application rule, when we asked for a coincidence, we're really asking for the coincidence of this S, which is what a type means rather than what it says. So it's also now the situation that instead of showing off that we have a type syntax by writing a total interpreter, we absolutely have to write an interpreter because otherwise we wouldn't be able to fill in pieces like this.
But you are asking what it means to be definitionally equal to the thing, whereas presumably
yes.
Actually some more extensional notion of being equal is
right.
What you
so
actually want.
So this is this is the reason why the paper is called Outrageous but Meaningful Coincidences. Because just demanding this coincidence is outrageous, and we are essentially piggybacking on the judgmental equality of Agda, and we might not mean that. This will work fine, provided the definitional equality or the judgmental equality of Agda is good for the judgmental equality that we actually want. Because what we're it's equality up to Agda's equality of these values. We haven't written down our own equational theory here, we're just being handed one by the meta language. So yes indeed, that would be harder. If for example we only wanted the theory up to beta conversion, then sorry, tough, you've got to have eta as well. If we wanted an even richer equational theory, then it's our tough luck to some extent that this technique.
So you could take something like category with attributes plus dot 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 sort of and do a free one in and would that be like doing a kind of combinatory version of time theory, would it? If you see what I mean. You do define a syntax but there are no variables or
behind
it. But so what's the relationship between that and I mean this is much more interesting than that.
You can play that game.
I suppose you could interpret one and the other or something.
You'd hope so. But it did have some fun manufacturing a combinatory version of type theory.
Yeah.
A while back. I wrote a Stack Overflow actually about it. across, because someone asked. So I thought, that's an interesting question. it got pretty hairy. Let me pull up. My Blue Peter file. Things I need earlier. And yes, here's the rest of the build. All of the equipment. And yes, okay, I will make application in fix operation. That means I have to that. Completely gratuitous combinator programming. The minus sign is the infix s operator, which is made to look as little like as much like an empty space as possible.
Just think if you allowed yourself to use Unicode.
Let me rewrite that as the if then else, this is so that's currying something, which means that we should look at the type in a minute. All I'm doing is plumbing the environment everywhere. That's what SMK do. They're plumbing for environments. You buy that? No, what's it? No, in the boat. Because it's the meaning of that. Now I'm losing quite badly. It's because I'm missing a set of parentheses. And now it's what's it complaining about? Yes, just it was always a mistake. Yeah, it ain't broke, it's not worth fixing.
You also have 2 weeks to find the old toy.
Yes, I think the right thing to do is to comment that out.
Yes.
And put a question mark in. Yeah, maybe. Then maybe I will discover what I need. Oh, I need a 2-arrow set. Oh, I see what's gone wrong. Yes, I already have the G somewhere. I don't need to abstract another one. And now it's completely got something else.
Yeah,
so Yeah, so P, let's look at the type of P. P is for the small if. P is something whose context is gamma extended by a boolean. That's the point. It's the dependent eliminator for the booleans. So it takes an element of type 2, and it takes a return type depending on a boolean, and then gratuitous bracket abstraction. Maybe if I can get this right, I can get the other one right. So P wants an environment, whereas the implementation of little if, is that ever anywhere? Must be somewhere else. Nice. Wants an element of the boolean, just be. So yeah, maybe it's just B. Yes, it's just B. Yeah. Okay, yes, that B
yes.
is the value of that thing. yeah. So let's just see what we've got. Our types are 0, 1, 2, nat, pi and sigma, and we've got big if, that's to say, we choose between two types. Our terms are, we have variables, the empty tuple, true and false, zero and successor, and then we have lambda and application. We have magic for eliminating the empty type. We've got dependent if-then-else for booleans, and we have primitive recursion, dependent primitive recursion for the natural numbers. I find, it becomes more readable when you decide just to completely ignore the bracket abstraction and currying combinators and just read the variables. It says P of N. we've got a P of zero, and we've got a for all N, P of N gives P a successor of N. So we've got an induction principle. We have dependent pairing, and we have the projections. And yet again, we need to use the interpretation to give the type of the second component, because it depends on the value of the first component. So that's those pieces. And then, all we're doing is mapping those syntactic constructs onto the corresponding operations on the underlying types.
So if we wanted to prove beta equality, presumably that would be pretty straightforward given this setup. Could you? You could just do it using REFL, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you want to check, let's do it. Maybe this is useful. Yes. So this gadget here. Lets us write down goals. So I don't actually seem to have propositional equality defined, but we would like to check what
if we've got, we're going to need an S and a T. We're going to need so the trouble is, if I really want to write down what beta is properly syntactically, then I have to define substitution, which we've not yet done.
Maybe let's do eta then.
Yes, indeed, we could do eta. So we want to say, for all G, if we want that, if we have some T which lives in P, S, T, and we would like to check that. That for all environments, we want to be sure that the meaning of T is equal to the meaning of lambda. I need a representation S, don't I? A representation of S, I say lambda S T. This point would say I haven't defined equality, so.
Or could you just do a function from one to the other and put the identity?
So I was just going to define, do it Leibniz style. Yeah. We're all P in something arrow set. And I'm going to hope it's going to figure something out. I've got to get it. It's a term with a free variable, so actually. What do I need to do? I need to make that a term, an environment for gamma S. What's it complaining about? And then I have I want a representation and sort of sheet. Now it's complaining about that. Now I'm not winning trying to write this down. It's always what happens when we win.
Could we go with G how it was before and then put in a weakening for the?
We don't know how to weaken terms, we only know how to weaken semantic objects.
So oh, yeah.
That's.
That's
brand new.
The trouble. Yeah, in fact, that's the issue, is that I can't weaken T.
Yeah.
So writing this down is non-trivial. So I'm going to stop trying. I haven't built here is the substitution structure, which is going to involve much more interesting things. But I thought I would just do. I think, to be honest. Let's see what happens. Could not pass what, so because I haven't told it in the it's Roger Henry's joke. I haven't told it that application associates to the left, rather as we all did in the 60s. So this is how to have the genuine experience of using a 1990s theorem prover in 2013. So we want to define addition as a function from nat to nat to nat. Let's deploy. We're going to have to first of all abstract at least one of the arguments. I think it's probably sensible to abstract two of them. So it's good we've got interactive term construction in the object theory. I will actually comment on the other ones, just so that we can see what we're doing. If you could call this being able to see what you're doing. Well, we can see the context, and we can, that's not bad. We can see the types of the assumptions. We can see the goal. Okay, so we are indeed going to need to deploy the primitive recursive. What order did I give this argument in? The number, yes, I see. So we're going to have to do recursion on var hot top. That's the first argument for people who are not Cylons. And then we're going to be doing recursion over things which are nat and nat. And now we need the zero case. So that's going to be our top. And then the successor case, we get given the original predecessor, and we get given the recursively computed sum. So we need to do the successor of var top. And that's a laugh. But let's just make sure that mine gets four. that is what for is. That's a silly thing to do. That's not what we want to normalize. We want to normalize what happens when you interpret for in some environment.
And if you're really keen, presumably you could actually prove that the interpretation of and was plus.
If we equipped this, there's no reason why we should not perform the observational type theory construction inside this universe equip it with a syntax for equality types and for REFL and for subst. And an interesting question indeed is whether we can prove that for every represented term, we got extensionally equal functions from environments to values. I haven't tried doing that, I'm actually itching to. I think I'll set that as an exercise. So we're not going to be able to do the external proof that observational equality is sort of good for all meta-language things, but we might be able to prove that it's good for all representable things in it. It's like to go up this way, which would be great if it happened. So it's certainly worth a go. I should stop, except to remark that in some other file, which I can find if you really insist, I have a small adaptation of this construction where instead of just giving an interpreter from environments to values, I extend this interpretation to a Kripke model so that I can actually extract syntactic normal forms. Then the coincidences in the application rule are saying, well, these types have the same representation in the Kripke model. But that's still good enough to allow the coincidences we need to be covered by the meta-language equality. If you wanted to have a richer notion of equality in one of these embedded type theories, a richer notion than the meta-language equality, you would indeed have to implement something like the observational type theory construction, because you need to be able to say that here are two types which, although Agda cannot see why they are the same, it's nonetheless possible to transport values from one to the other. I think combining the stuff of this afternoon is a really interesting thing to try to do. But yeah, that's some reason to believe we can build a dependent type theory which has what sorts of stuff. It has some sort of closed universe of either inductive families or even inductive recursive definitions. And it has a proof-irrelevant notion of proposition. It has an observational notion of equality. And it's capable of reflecting a large fragment of itself in a type-safe way. What's this course really been about? It's about using Agda to build the bits and pieces that show that we can do a lot better than Agda if we thought about it.